Good morning, Saints. My name is Pastor Eugene Taylor of Emmanuel Church in Christ in Clarksville, Tennessee. We welcome you here. There are many things you could be doing with your precious time. We thank you for serving with us. If you get a chance, go on YouTube and like us or give us a comment to let us know how we're doing. Before I start, I would like to start off with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. And Father, we thank you for allowing us to be safe. And Father, we thank you for our health. Thank you for our strength. We thank you just for allowing us to be in your kingdom. And Father, we had a tornado come through here a couple of days ago. A lot of people got killed. And Father, we thank you for just your saving mercy and grace for saving us. And Father, I should prepare our hearts and words for this message. Heavenly Father, when the word goes out, let the word not come back void. Heavenly Father, when the word goes out, let the word fall on good ground. Heavenly Father, we ask you to remove all distractions. Heavenly Father, I ask you to decrease me and increase you through me. Heavenly Father, I'm asking these and all other blessings in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. And then when I look back over my life, look back at how good God has been to me. I just want to thank him for where he brought me from. You know, when I was 2 years old, my mother and father were divorced. And after a while, my father, who had myself and my sister, he got married again. So then I got a new stepmom. Once I got a new stepmom, we moved to a different location. It was kind of hard for a young child or young kids. I was 2 years old, my sister was about 4 years old. Kind of hard to move to a different location for divorce. And when parents get divorced, it's hard for the parents, but also hard for the children. But I was blessed enough to get a saved stepmom. My mom was saved. We're having my father did like all good men do. He went out and worked 2 different jobs and brought the money home and took care of us, provided food and shelter. But my mom was the one that actually raised us. As a matter of fact, it appears that I was raised in the church. I remember back, I was get up in the morning and go to Sunday school. After Sunday school, go to church. After church, we eat dinner at church. After that, we had another musical going on. And I go home, like the next day or so, we had choir rehearsal. I remember I was a little boy. I used to go to choir rehearsal. I know it was late at night. I used to fall asleep at church. One time I fell asleep and fell off the bench. And then sometime after choir rehearsal, next day, my mother would work in the kitchen sometimes. They'd sell pies and sell cakes and stuff. It seems I was raised in the church. One thing my mother did was she sang in a choir called the Belle d'Air, sang in the choir. So sometimes it seemed like to me that things that the parents do is passed down to the children. What happened is my sister, she's a minister, and she sings. I'm a minister, and I visit people in prison. My mom did the same thing. It's not to me that what happens to the parents is passed down to the children. So, but the only thing about it, I know once my parents got divorced, it seemed like things changed. Not necessarily with my family, but I noticed other families that maybe not your family, but other families that possibly after someone gets divorced, they started drinking alcohol, doing drugs, smoking cigarettes, being unfaithful, doing all kind of different strange stuff. Saying divorce affects people because some people become depressed. So what comes to my mind is it possible to have a generational curse or be affected by what your parents do? Let's see what the word says about it. Go me to Exodus, the 20th chapter, verses 4 and 5. Exodus 20, verses 4 and 5. It reads, "You shall not make for yourself an image of the form of anything in heaven, above or on earth, beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me." I want to use for a subject, generational curses. Generational curses. I read it to you again. "You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third or fourth generations of those who hate me." I want to discuss, what are generational curses? How to discover them, and how to break generational curses. My first point, what is a generational curse? You know, it's pretty much things that your ancestors did, believe, or practice, and the consequences of sin was passed down to the next generation. Some people call generational curses family curses. The reason I say that is because the dad was in jail, the son was in jail, the mother or father dropped out of school, kids dropped out of school, parents didn't go to college, kids didn't go to college. They had a family that didn't believe in getting married, they believed in shacking up, kids did the same thing. Grandma lived in the projects, granddad lived in the projects. Your mother and father did the same thing, they lived in the projects. Your father, he sold drugs. The kids sold drugs too. Someone in your family or your mother or father smoked crack. You smoked crack too. My point is, some things are passed down from sinful behavior. So would you agree with me that family attributes or physical attributes are passed down? For example, if you got brown eyes, your parents got brown eyes. If you're angry, your parents are angry, you have anger issues also, you have the same issues as your parents might have. Sometimes we think or blame stuff on generational curses, it might just be stuff like unchecked sin in your life. The generational curses are curses according to the Bible, but some stuff is just unchecked sin, just sin in your life. It said you should not make for yourself any images of form of anything in heaven or above the earth. Some people have images and idols. They worship other stuff to God. It says, "You would not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord, your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children of the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generations." Punishing sounds like it's unfair. But Jesus died for our sins to pay the price. So in those days, the Bible used to say, this is Jeremiah 31:29, "The parents have eaten sour grapes, but the children have bitter taste in their mouth." That's the way it used to be. But now, the parents ate sour grapes, they have the sourness in their mouth. In other words, what the parents do, the kids won't be held accountable for it. But sometimes, like I mentioned earlier, the characteristics are stuff that passes on, like the eyes color, the anger issues, it passes down through generations. But what this is like the character of sin or addictions is passed down to the children. In other words, if your father or mother have a sinful lifestyle, the children will possibly also have a sinful lifestyle. They have a choice, yeah, but still they might have a sinful lifestyle. Matthew the 15th, now Matthew 1 and 5 and 6, I'm paraphrasing, it says, Simon and Rahab were the parents of Boaz. Boaz and Ruth were the parents of Obed. Obed was the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of King David. David and Uriah's wife were parents of Solomon. Rahab, the prostitute, was the great-great-grandmother of King David. The Bible says your sins will find you out. But they can also be positive. For example, have you heard of Archie Manning? He played for the New Orleans Saints from 71 to 82. He's a quarterback. You might not remember his name, but you mentioned his sons, Eli and Peyton Manning, the great quarterbacks. This is something their father did. They received those attributes also. Look at Bishop T.D. Jakes. He's a wonderful preacher. He speaks and teaches the word. His daughter, Sarah Robert Jakes, she's a preacher. So when you pass down stuff to your kids, what are you passing down? Are you passing down blessings? Are you passing down curses? Psalms 50 and 1 said, God owned the cattle on a thousand hills. In other words, what he has everything. He won't give you what you want, he'll give you what you need, but you have to be a part of him. You have to have a relationship with him. Psalms 34 and 8 said, oh, taste and see how good God is. If you don't believe me, try him. So the sins of the parents, they do have an effect on the children. But what it does is the sins the parents have, it opens up a door for Satan to come in. Now Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. So you open this door up, Satan will come in. And parents open the door for idolatry, other types of sin. They make the children more vulnerable. The parents are supposed to have a spiritual protection for the children. When they don't do that, they expose themselves and their family to Satan. So there are four different types, well, there are several different types of generational curses, but I just want to talk about four different types. I want to talk about worshiping idols, sinful patterns, destructive behavior, and physical and mental sicknesses. So, idols. Idols is like it sounds. Idols is worshiping something instead of God. Most people think it's a graven image of gold or something, but it could be a grandchild, a wife, husband, car, job, dealing with magic or mysticism, being one with God. Magic, you know, magic is like black magic, doing something negative, something you shouldn't be doing, dealing with the mediums. Mysticism is like meditation and think yourself you're one with God and the Holy Spirit. Dealing with evil spirits and idols overshadows persons and life with darkness and unexplainable sickness and pain. The next type of curse I want to talk about is sinful patterns. Sinful patterns is like unhealthiness passed down to the children, unfaithfulness, in other words, having extramarital affairs. So if your parents struggle with something, kids might have a harder time struggling with it too. If one of your parents couldn't control anger, your kids might have the same problem. They can't control anger neither. The same could be said about anger, worry, grief, unbelief, and deception. Abraham used deception to protect himself before a king. Abraham felt he was in danger. He asked Sarah to lie about his wife, and so she claimed to be his sister. What happened was Abraham's son, Isaac, fell to the exact same trap. Jacob used deception like his father. The third destructive behavior is suicide. Then we try to harm yourself. Self-harm can become from the parents to the children. Abuse of all kinds can end up passing down from the family line through generations, like addiction, alcohol, drugs, marital problems, strongholds in families, destructive generational behaviors. Some stuff is easy to find, but some stuff might be more subtle. For example, Acts 7:51 says, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you always resist the Holy Spirit as your father did, so you." So what this is talking about is it was resisting God, resisting God's work, God's word. For example, like some of us today, we know about God, but we still won't go to church. The fourth type of generational curse was a physical or mental sickness. You know, you go to the doctor about, say, a blood pressure issue. The first thing the doctor does is say, give me your medical history. You know, if you have diabetes, you'll say, your mother have it, your father have it, sister have it, brother have it, who died from this, who died from that, who has cancer. So what he tries to do is, he says, certain things are passed on from the parents to the children. And I'm here to tell you that some sicknesses are physical, but many sicknesses, which the doctors probably don't know, are from the spiritual side. For an inclusive list of these sicknesses, look at Deuteronomy 28, chapter, verses 20 through 60. It talks about the plagues that was given from the parents to the descendants. Have you noticed people with cancer, heart disease, many issues, fertility issues? They're prone to getting the same disease for their kids. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm trying to get you ready for 2022 to have a spiritual outlook, have a new season, and be come out being spiritual gift, or not spiritual gift, but generational curse free. So how do you discover a generational curse? But before you discover a generational curse, you must identify it. You know, you got to know what it is before you can do anything about it. John 10:10 says, Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. You know, some family curses are recurring. In other words, they start with the grandmother, grandfather, and they still go to the kids, and they destroy your future. Scripture is clear. God visits the iniquity of his children up to the third and fourth generations. Curses, they don't visit your family without a cause. If someone has a curse, someone in the family allowed it to get in there. What happened? They opened the door for the spirits to enter. Some family issues are really easy to find. You can look at them, easy to find. Others are less apparent. Something like alcoholism, it's really easy to see. A kid can see a person that's nice when he's not drunk. When he or she gets drunk, he acts like Dr. Jekyll, Mrs. Hyde. He acts different. He gets anger problems. He might want to start a fight with the spouse, beat the kids, or just do crazy stuff. So alcoholism itself might not necessarily be generational curse, but the sin is associated with it because of certain predispositions. It causes you to have drink alcohol. It's a predisposition like the skin, color of the hair, eyes, and a mental capacity, the way you think. It's all passed down. Some of the consequences come from the genes, not necessarily come from the curses. So what about infidelity? Psalms 51 and 5. This is David talking now. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. So Matthew 1, 5 through 6. Simon and Rahab were the parents of Boaz. Boaz and Ruth were the parents of Obed. Obed was the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of King David. David and Uriah's wife were the parents of Solomon. Notice they didn't mention David's mother. So David said, "In sin, my mother conceived me." In other words, David's mother wasn't the mother of the other kids. Look at Jesse. He had 12 sons. David was out in the field doing something. So maybe he was, I don't know, maybe he was a different son, like a stray sheep or something. Maybe he didn't like him. I don't know what the issue. But what my point is, if Rahab was a prostitute, that sin they had in the family, it stayed in the family. Said Jesse had 12 sons, but Jesse was his father, biological father, but he had a different mother. So the fornication was passed down through the family at a wedlock. What happened? When I say fornication, David was the king. He saw Bathsheba bathing. I don't know why she was bathing. Maybe it was that certain time of the month when they had to cleanse themselves. But anyway, David saw her. He called his son for her. She came. They got together. And they had a child. But David, being the smart man he was, tried to cover it up. So he said, let Uriah come home, but Uriah didn't have relations with his wife. So David instructs the other men, once the battle gets hot, send Uriah there, and you fall back. So David used deception, tried to cover up his mess, but it didn't work. Nathan said, the sword should never depart from thine house. The prophet Nathan told him, because thou hast despised me, the Lord, and hast taken the wife of Uriah. Numbers 33 and 23 says, your sins will find you out. After this, his favorite son, Absalom, he slept with his father's wives. Leviticus 20:11 says, and the man that lieth with his father's wife uncovered and uncovers his father's nakedness, both of them shall be put to death. So what he did was a bad thing. Just remember, the sin come from way up here, Rahab. It's coming down through the family. Holy Spirit, help me to get this right. Holy Spirit, come into my heart. Absalom did some wicked stuff too. Amnon loved his, he looked at his sister, how beautiful she was, and he raped her. So Absalom murdered him. You see what I'm saying? I just started up with Rahab coming on down. So what about your finances? You know, it's Christmas time now. You go out and use your credit card and buy all kinds of stuff you don't need, spend thousands and thousands of dollars, and then January 15th is when you got to pay this stuff, which you don't really need in the first place. Deuteronomy 28:17 says, cursed shall be thy basket and thy store, and thou shalt grope at noonday as the blind goeth in darkness. And thou shalt not prosper in ways, and thou shalt be only oppressed and spoiled evermore, and no man shall save thee. What this is saying, this is like a curse on your finances. It's talking about needing of the dough. This is like where your food is prepared. It's saying, what it's saying is the ability to get wealth will be stopped. It's like putting money into a bag with holes in it. Or if you try to get a garden hose and drink water out of it in your hands, how you drink some water but keep running out, this is what it's like. A cousin of mine, he used to say, every time I get a dime, ruin a nickel. And once upon a time, I had several credit cards, four or five credit cards, and there was a couple of them was maxed out. It's like you can't get ahead. You're buying all this unnecessary stuff. Mess, I got tired, sick and tired of being sick and tired of paying this debt off, so I got rid of my credit cards. I cut most of them up. Now, if I want something, I just save up for it and buy it. I'm here to tell you, saints, it's Christmas time. Now, I know it's Christmas time, but credit cards are a trap. Deuteronomy 28 and 47 says, because thou serve not the Lord and thy God with joyfulness and with gladness of heart for the abundance of all things. Therefore shalt thou serve thine enemies, that the Lord shall end against thee, and hunger, and thirst, nakedness, and want all things, and he shall put a yoke of iron about thy neck until he has destroyed thee. I'm talking about tax collectors now, you know. You know, you got to get paid, you got somebody pay this bill, pay that bill, that bill, that bill. They have a noose around your neck. It's too much. So if you're under a curse, you might have a good job, good fun, but the stuff comes in, you squander it. You waste it. You're getting a further debt. You know, you have a good job and you want to go after these schemes or just financial schemes, you know. You might play the lottery or use these pyramid schemes. Or you have a friend of yours who wants to start a business, or you want to use your money to start this business. Matthew 6 and 33 says, the blessed man is not confused on material wealth, but his purpose is to follow God and keep God's commandments. What he does is he puts God first. I don't know about you, but when I get my paycheck, pay my bills, have a little bit of money left over, it almost gives me a headache to just get the money and pay my bills. I'm sure some of you might be in the same situation, make me feel sick. So do you think sickness is a generational curse or just something that everyone experiences? Do you think sickness is hereditary? Deuteronomy 28 and 21 says, the Lord shall make the pestilences cleave unto thee, until he has consumed thee from off the land, whither thou goest to possess it. The Lord shall smite thee with consumption, and with fever, and with inflammation, and with extreme burning, and with the word, and with blasting, and with mildew, and they shall pursue thee until thou perish. Some families have sickness that's recurring. In other words, recurrence indicates to me that it's a generational curse. Notice the terms already was pestilence and consumption. Consumption is like lung disease, emphysema, COPD, lung cancer. Lung cancer is like the number 3 or 4 killer in the world. Yeah, I mean, in the U.S., you have fever, inflammation, arthritis, or brain inflammation leads to Alzheimer's disease. You have extreme points, meaning fever. So the top leading cause of death in America are heart disease, cancer. They say COVID is number 3 now, and it's still growing. The last thing I want to talk about is how to discover generational curses. This is simple patterns. I spoke about simple patterns earlier, but simple patterns are really important, so I want to talk about it again. Simple patterns could be addiction to alcohol, drugs, pornography, divorce, infidelity, witchcraft, marital breakdowns, shacking up, gambling, lying, cheating, or deception like Job, Jacob, and Abraham had. Satan comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Satan knows that his time is getting short. He's trying to deceive everybody he can. What he's doing is he's coming against the head of the households, whether it be the male or the female. Several people in my family, they say, they love the Lord. They talk to him on the phone, say, how you doing today? Praise God, praise God. I'm getting older and smarter now, you know. If I get to go out and see apple tree, some apples should be on the ground. I got a grapevine outside, and some grapes should be on the ground. You listen to them, they talk about, I love God, and the same person, you talk about, they have a girlfriend and boyfriend, they say they love the girlfriend and boyfriend, and they go out and see someone else in the world. Otherwise, they go out and cheat. So if you love God, it should become kind of sign. If you love me, you got to show me. I just tell me. People tell you anything. It's like natural. You see somebody, hi, bye. It's a natural response. I love you. I love you. You got to show some sign about love. If you come in contact with Jesus, the things you used to do, you won't do them anymore. Just praise God, saints. Acts 7:51 says, you stiff-necked and uncircumcised in your heart and ears, yours resist the Holy Spirit, as your fathers did, you do also. In other words, these children or kids or whatever, their parents probably didn't go to church. They don't go to church neither. Because if you love God, you'll show some kind of sign. So if you still don't know what a generational curse is, something your ancestors did, believe, or practice, and the consequences of sin is passed down to the next generation. My first point was, what is a generational curse? My point two was, how to discover a generational curse. I gave you an example of Rahab, how she was a prostitute, but she was King David's great-great-grandmother, to see how infidelity was passed down through generations. So, how do you discover these generational curses? If you lack passion for spiritual things, you deal with infidelity, you have a sickness that your parents or grandparents had the same sickness, you have the same mental disease, emotional or physical fatigue, if you're alluded to something that you struggle with it, can't get rid of it, some type of bondage, you try to fix your financial problems over and over again, but you can't seem to get ahead. If you find yourself in the same sinful patterns as your parents did, you might be facing generational curses. Ephesians 6 and 12. For we wrestle not against the flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual weaknesses in high places. So how do you get rid of generational curses? How do you get rid of generational curses? Repentance. Repentance. What happened when the children of Israel, they would worshiping these idols, they came to God, asked for repentance. When they repented, the curses was broken. So the cure for generational curses is repentance. Faith in Christ, having a life consecrated by God. I mean by consecration is having a life devoted to God. So to get from under the generational curse, you have to be grafted to a new family. In other words, the thing you used to do in the past, don't do those things anymore. You have become a part of God's family. John 10:10 says, a thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But the other part I didn't read was, God comes to give you life, give it to you more abundantly. Proverbs 18:21 said, the power of life and death is in the tongue. Ephesians 25 says, you should not bow down to them or worship them. No, Exodus 20:5 says, you should not bow down to them or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for their parents to the third and fourth generation who hate me. But right behind that is Exodus 20:6. By showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. Saints, this is a no-brainer. The choice is, do you want to have curses for three or four generations? Or do you want to pick blessings for a thousand generations? Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, keep my commandments. If you love your children, keep God's commandments. If you want the blessings for a thousand generations, keep God's commandments. So now I want to let us pray. We'll talk about generational curse today. Got my book out. I want to make sure I get it right about generational curses, how to break them, because this is an important thing. New Year's is almost here. You got a new year coming up, you know, you need to figure out how to adequately break these generational curses. If you're in your house, I want you to go to a quiet place from all distractions. If you have favorite Christian songs, put that on just to make a shallow, slow, quiet atmosphere. Heavenly Father, I ask you to forgive me for all my sins, transgressions, iniquities, trespasses, and any unforgiveness I have in my heart. I ask for all forgiveness, transgressions, iniquities, and trespasses that will expose me to a curse, whether committed by me, my relatives, ancestors, or others committed to me. It is my will that I forgive all those who have harmed me or wronged me. I want you, Heavenly Father, to forgive me. I forgive anybody who has hurt me or wronged me, my children, or grandchildren. I renounce and repent from all conducts. I renounce and repent from all conduct with anything cultic or satanic or any secret society that binds me against the will of my Heavenly Father. I commit to remove anything from my house that the Holy Spirit says is satanic and needs to be removed. I cancel all Satan's claims against me and my family. Lord Jesus, I believe that on the cross, you took upon yourself every curse that should and would come over against me. Lord Jesus, I ask you to destroy every curse that is on me at this time, that has been put on my children, my grandchildren, my family, according to your will. So now I release myself from any curse, any evil influence over me or my family from my source whatsoever. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, if it's your will, by faith, receive it, release from any curses you have broken, I thank you in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, I just thank you for breaking all these curses. I believe in you right now. Just may the grace of God, the love of Jesus, and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest through and abide forever until we meet again. Amen.